talking about his advocacies in the budget, of which he is not really known for publicly. He was talking about how money, if devolved to the local governments, would greatly aid in the development of the countryside. As someone who came from local government, I knew how true this was. But in the course of our conversation, our guest speaker spoke about certain matters in the 2015 budget and in the proposed 2016 budget. And I was quite surprised about what he was telling me. But knowing our guest speaker as a man who is very careful with what he does, with what he says, who is very good at investigative work, who undertakes completed staff work in everything he does, I said, this is true. And this is something that is an FEF matter. In fact, it is a national issue. So I immediately called up our president, President Toti, and told him about it. And I said, you know, our guest speaker, he's saying something that is really of national importance and not known to many. I said, this is really a matter for the FEF. So I said, can we invite him? And we had dinner, President Toti, our guest speaker, and several fellows, and we had preliminary discussions on his findings. And we agreed that once he had put them all together, once all of the evidence was in place, then he would kindly speak before us. So tonight he is with us again, thankfully. Our guest of honor and speaker, a friend, is a member of the Matatag class of 1971 of the Philippine Military Academy. He is a distinguished servant leader in our country, known for his distinctive phrase, I quote, "What is right must be kept right. What is wrong must be set right." A personal credo he has faithfully observed in his more than 40 years of public service as a law enforcer, legislator, and rehabilitation czar, and now as budget expert. His rise to national consciousness started when he catapulted the Philippine National Police to one of its highest public approval ratings in history. Not only did he restore the PNP to its glory days, his stint as chief PNP also sparked a grueling yet worthwhile uphill climb for this man from Imus, Cavite. A while ago, our guest of honor and Secretary Gary Teves were talking about waistlines. When our guest of honor was chief PNP, everybody had just to go down to 34. And we missed those days. But one thing I did not know, and which I am publicly telling you now, is that apparently during the time of Secretary Gary Teves as president of Land Bank, he also had this incentive to have everyone bring down their waistlines to a certain size. During his two consecutive terms as a senator, he had consistently not availed of his annual 200 million Priority Development Assistance Fund, or PDAF entitlement, commonly known as pork barrel, as part of his sturdy crusade against graft and corruption. He served as chairman of the Senate Committee on National Defense, Committee on Civil Service and Government Reorganization, Committee on Ethics, and the Committee on Accounts. His legislative record is packed with significant laws that are of interest to FEF because they are along our line, that he authored and sponsored, which includes, among others, Republic Act number 9485, the Anti-Red Tape Act of 2007, which maybe we can comment on if it's really being implemented as the law intended it to be. Because a while ago I heard Secretary Bertie Lim and Samuel Paterno talking about the cost of doing business, the cost of compliance. The Republic Act number 10167, an act to further strengthen the anti-money laundering law. Republic Act number 10354, an act providing for a national policy on responsible parenthood and reproductive health. And Republic Act number 9416, the Anti-Cheating Act of 2007, which is actually an act that makes cheating in civil service examinations a criminal offense, among others. In the aftermath of Super Typhoon Yolanda that caused widespread destruction, damage, and death in central Philippines, President Benigno S. Aquino III appointed him as Presidential Assistant for Rehabilitation and Recovery with the mandate of unifying the rehabilitation and recovery efforts of government and other agencies. As the overall manager and coordinator, his office crafted the comprehensive rehabilitation and recovery plan with a 167 billion proposed funding, which provides for an overall strategic vision and integrated programs in the Yolanda-affected areas. His efforts in the Yolanda rehabilitation led to the institutionalization of essential mechanisms on rehabilitation of calamity-affected communities. Fellows in FEF, ladies and gentlemen, let us all give a warm welcome to the Honorable Senator Panfilo Lacson.
Thank you very much, Chiefy, for the kind introduction. When a speaker uses a PowerPoint presentation, either he respects his audience so much because he's overprepared, or he doesn't trust his audience because they might fall asleep while he's talking. I'm using a PowerPoint presentation. I won't tell you which is which. The President Toti, the Board of Advisors, Board of Trustees, officers, members of the Foundation for Economic Freedom, guests, ladies and gentlemen. Let me start with a relevant dictum from the great Albert Einstein. He said, and I quote, "The strength of the Constitution lies entirely in the determination of each citizen to defend it. Only if every single citizen feels duty-bound to do his share in its defense are the constitutional rights secure," unquote. Yesterday, September 1, 2015, sparked a pivotal turn of events, taking off from anomalies recently discovered in the 2015 General Appropriations Act. A body of concerned citizens and budget advocates marched to the halls of the Supreme Court in a petition to prohibit cunning machinations in the expenditure of the national budget to circumvent the safeguards established by no less than the fundamental law of the land. Without doubt, you play a critical role in influencing policymakers in government, business, and industry in our collective aim for inclusive growth and development. For this, I'm with you as you continue your efforts towards economic and development-oriented reforms. As a former public servant, like some, if not most of you, I also have my aspirations, my dream, and vision for our dearly beloved country. Ito ay makitang bawat Pilipino ay namumuhay na mapayapa, masagana, at may dangal. Every citizen must have equal opportunity to pursue a prosperous life. Government must provide a level playing field. Those who have less must have more from government. We collectively fight to curb corruption and protect the best interests of the greater Filipino masses, because this is what democracy is all about and what democratic leaders are elected for, in pursuit of their sworn ideals of public service. I firmly believe then and now that the national budget is the lifeblood of our economic well-being, if not the country itself. This is the reason why in my years of public service, I have been a staunch advocate of transparency and accountability in the national budget. This evening, you assigned me to discuss two fundamental issues in line with our shared advocacy. First is the recent Supreme Court ruled unconstitutional National Budget Circular 541 and the Disbursement Acceleration Program, or DAP. And second, the reverse of the pork barrel in the 2015 national budget. On October 12, 2011, the Aquino administration orchestrated the Disbursement Acceleration Program, better known as DAP, which according to them was meant to accelerate government spending and push forth economic growth. In support of the program, the Department of Budget and Management then issued National Budget Circular 541, or NBC 541, which gave the budget department the authority to pull and declare as savings unobligated, unutilized, and unreleased appropriations, not at the end of the fiscal year, but the second quarter. Both the DAP and NBC 541 were declared unconstitutional by the Supreme Court on July 1, 2014. On what grounds? First, the Supreme Court said that you cannot shorten the validity period of the fund allocation for one fiscal year. Second, the Supreme Court stated that the cross-border transfer is not allowed. Third, implementing projects, activities, and programs, or PAPs, that are not included in the approved GAA is prohibited. Fourth and finally, the court ruled that it is unconstitutional to use the unprogrammed funds without the certification from the National Treasurer, saying that revenue collections exceeded the revenue targets. However, our scrutiny of the 2015 GAA has revealed the obvious reincarnation of both the DAP and NBC 541 through sections 70 and 73 under the general provisions of the Republic Act 10651 or the 2015 GAA. Let me explain. In the national budgets from 2002 to 2014, the term savings was given a definitive meaning to refer to the portions or balances of any program appropriations free from any obligations or encumbrances. However, in the 2015 GAA, we have observed how the Executive Department, through the DBM, revived the unconstitutional NBC 541 by redefining savings. The meaning of savings was amended in the 2015 GAA. Essentially, the new definition of savings refers to portions or balances of any program appropriations which have not been released or obligated as a result of the following. One, final discontinuance and or abandonment of the projects, programs, and activities or PAPs at any time by the head of the agency concerned. Number two, non-commencement of PAPs. Number three, decreased cost resulting from improved implementation of PAPs. And four, the difference between the approved budget for the contract and the contract award price. What are the effects of this redefinition of the word savings? The new definition of savings provided by Section 70 allows the creation of what we call artificial savings. This is contrary to the ruling of the Supreme Court on Arroyo et al. Versus Aquino on July 1, 2014, which provides that actual rather than artificial savings must be realized before the power to augment may be exercised. I'd like to quote a portion of that ruling. Savings should be actual. Actual denotes something that is real or substantial, or something that exists presently in fact, as opposed to something that is merely theoretical, possible, potential, or hypothetical. The redefined meaning of savings also unduly authorizes the heads of the national government agencies to determine savings. Those who have creative minds may say that the legislature went out of bounds of what the constitutional meaning of savings is. Thus, they gravely abused their discretion in redefining the meaning of savings. To what end? To pull artificial savings, use the same in augmenting the budget for projects under their discretion, and allow the use of savings contrary to their intended appropriations. This will be fully substantiated in our discussion of Section 73 of the 2015 GAA, which refers to the realignment and reprioritization of funds. Of the Section 73 of the 2015 General Appropriations Act provides that agencies must spend what is programmed in their appropriations. The heads of the agencies are, however, given the authority to reprioritize and or realign their budgets to other PAPs subject to the observance of certain rules under the said section. Let us take, for example, the realignments and reductions of the funding allocation for capital outlay of the Department of Health, which are intended for the repair, construction, and development of infrastructures and procurement of medical facilities and equipment under the 2015 GAA. According to the 2015 GAA, Mariano Marcos Memorial Hospital and Medical Center in Batac, Ilocos Norte has 171 million in fund allocation. We discovered that the approved budget was blatantly cut by 112,966,427, thus reducing it to 58 million. Obviously, not at the end of the fiscal year 2015, since we're not yet there. How can we fulfill our commitment to provide quality health services if we can easily violate the Constitution and slash out the appropriated funds for the agencies, such as in the case of the Mariano Marcos Memorial Hospital? Upon the other hand, there are hospitals which have not been allotted funds in the 2015 national budget, such as the Cagayan Valley Memorial Medical Center and the Maribeles Mental Hospital, but later received 50 million pesos in funds, by whose power? None other than a constitutionally infirm memorandum order issued by DOH Director 3, Maria Rebecca Peñapiel, in mid-year or on June 9, 2015. This, ladies and gentlemen of this benighted land, is just the tip of the iceberg. Anomalies abound in the 2015 budget allocations of the Department of Health. We elaborated on these matters in the petition that like-minded individuals filed before the Supreme Court yesterday. What can we tell about these illustrations? First, funds were appropriated for Mariano Marcos Medical Center in the GAA, but these were substantially reduced based on a DOH release memorandum. Second, hospitals, which have not been allotted any amount in the GAA, were given funds through the same memorandum. Third, by this scheme, the DOH was able to pull substantial amount of money, and for what purpose? Only the current DOH secretary can answer. The above illustrations clearly indicate violations of Section 29, Paragraph 1, Article 6 of the Constitution, which provides that, and I quote, "No money shall be paid out of the Treasury except in pursuance of an appropriation made by law," unquote. Corollary with this principle is the prohibition against the passage of any law allowing transfer of appropriations under the first clause of Section 25, Paragraph 5, Article 6 of the Constitution, which provides, and I quote, "No law shall be passed authorizing any transfer of appropriations. However, the President of the Senate, the Speaker of the House of Representatives, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, and the heads of the constitutional commissions may, by law, be authorized to augment any item in the general appropriations law for their respective offices from savings in other items of their respective appropriations." Can DOH and DBM get away with this schematic manipulations of public funds? We do not think so. Tonight, I pose this alarming question to all of you. Has pork really left us? A closer look at the budget of the Department of Agriculture in the 2015 GAA would show that the Unconstitutional Priority Development Assistance Fund, or pork barrel, has never left and appears to have no intention to ever disappear, no matter how much we keep on opposing it. For this year, the total budget of the Department of Agriculture is 39 billion pesos. One of those that caught our attention is the item Farm to Market Roads, with a lump sum budget of 6,250,000,000 pesos. Looking at the 2015 National Expenditure Program, or NEP, or the President's budget, the lower house and Senate versions of the General Appropriations Bill, the said lump sum was allotted to the Department of Agriculture regional offices in the entire country. In the errata sheets submitted by DBM Secretary Abad to Chairman Isidro Ungab of the House of Representatives Committee on Appropriations on October 3, 2014, there was no disaggregation of the 126.25 billion pesos into specific projects under the proposed lump sum. Consequently, the Bicameral Conference Committee report of the 2015 GAA also shows no breakdown of the said lump sum appropriation. Therefore, there is no record of the disaggregated farm-to-market road items for the 6.25 billion pesos lump sum allocations of the DA during the entire legislative process. Much to our surprise, these regional lump sums just disappeared in the approved General Appropriations Act and were replaced by 1,389 line budget items for farm-to-market road projects across the country. This, to my mind, constitutes a violation of the origination clause provided for in Article 6, Section 24, which provides, and I quote, all appropriations, revenue or tariff bills, bills authorizing an increase in public debt, bills of local application, and private bills shall originate exclusively in the House of Representatives, but the Senate may propose or concur with amendments, unquote. These line budget items were not discussed during the deliberations of either the House of Representatives or the Senate. And even in the bicameral conference, in the bicameral report ratified by both houses of Congress. Hence, we ask, where did these line budget items come from? Not having been deliberated by both houses of Congress, these line budget items were magically included in the version of the 2015 GAA as printed. One significant question is, who stands to benefit from this? Your guess is as good as mine. I will henceforth narrate to you. In July 2015, a concerned citizen came across several farm-to-market road projects, which are among the anomalous 1,389 line budget items under the GAA. The horrible part is that pictures of these ongoing projects bear or billboards of members of the Congress taking acknowledgement and credits for the project's implementation. These actions speak badly of the ruling of the Supreme Court in Belgica versus Executive Secretary that, and I quote, legal provisions of past and present congressional pork barrel laws, such as the previous PDAF and CDF articles and the various congressional insertions, are unconstitutional, unquote. Clearly, the insertion of the 1,389 line budget items in the GAA, which were conspicuously absent in all the budget books prior to the printing of the 2015 GAA, and the billboards of the legislators, are clearly alarm bells that signify the reverse of the unconstitutionally declared PDAF. Year in, year out, we always declare the existence of savings, but we always end up short and resort to borrowings. This is the vicious cycle of inefficient and corruption-prone public financial management system. Case in point is our 2.2 trillion peso budget in 2014, of which a significant amount was left unspent. This unspent fund is composed of the continuing appropriations amounting to 110 billion pesos and unused appropriations with a total amount of 392 billion. Thus, for 2014, we have a total of 502 billion pesos savings, and yet we still had a deficit of 73.1 billion for that same year. Today, the outstanding debt of the national government amounts to 6.3 trillion pesos. of the 100 million population, Filipinos aged 15 and above are now over 63.6 million. This means that to eliminate the national debt, each of us, wala namang below 15 dito, would have to pay 99,000 pesos. Last week, the National Economic and Development Authority, or NEDA, announced that for the second quarter of this year, the Philippines increased its gross domestic product, or GDP, by 5.6%, which is higher than the 5% that we reached in the first quarter. As compared to the other Asian countries or economies that have released their second quarter 2015 GDP growth data, it is reported that the Philippines is the third fastest growing economy and is ahead of Malaysia at 4.9%, Indonesia at 4.7%, and Thailand at 2.8%. But then, we are left with doubts. Does this increase in our growth data trickle down to the poor? Is this progress commensurate to the needs of the greater population? This is precisely the reason why a few months ago, I have started an information drive about my personal advocacy on the equitable distribution of the national budget to local government units aimed at creating more development opportunities, thus improving the delivery of basic services, especially in the far-flung communities. After years of careful and thorough analysis, we have observed that if the national government would, at the very least, adhere to the guidelines set by the Commission on Audit, that the expenditures should not be A, irregular, B, unnecessary, C, extravagant, D, excessive, and E, unconscionable. Easily, there can be at least 500 billion pesos composed of very rational deductions from the regular budget, special purpose funds, and automatic appropriations, which can be allocated to the local government units all over the country. With the assumption that this 500 billion will be distributed equitably to fund development projects, programs, and activities, we can provide every year on top of the 20% of the local government's revenue share through the Internal Revenue Allotment, or IRA, approximately 81 billion pesos, or 1 billion each, to our 81 provinces, 149 billion or 100 million each, or to each of the 1,490 municipalities, 43 billion or 300 million to each of the 144 cities, and 210 billion or 5 million pesos each to the 42,026 barangays in the country. This would, of course, depend on the modality of distribution and implementation of local development projects every year. Just imagine if this 500 billion pesos is translated into projects like livelihood activities, infrastructure improvement, and industry enterprise development in each and every province, city, municipality, and barangay. This could mean more job opportunities, which direct to higher income of Filipino families. Subsequently, such would result in firmer domestic demands, efficient production, and a more stable consumption of goods and services. Through this manner, we can be certain that our growth as a nation is beneficial to the greater population. In sum, the inclusive growth that we often hear from our economic planners and policymakers will cease to become mere lip service, but a reality. We keep asking ourselves, what must be done? We keep thinking of new laws and new rules, new systems even, in our desire to fight corruption. We keep thinking of new ways to entice investments, to make our economy produce more and create more jobs for an ever-increasing population. We keep calling for moral revolution, exhorting all in a crusade for change, forgetting that change must begin with the leaders, that leadership by example is the most powerful agent of change. And the first step also means choosing among us those who can lead by the power of good and selfless example, with unwavering determination to reform government, discard the politics of compromise and unseemly transaction, and instead act like true and genuine public servants. Nothing less will suffice. Come 2016, we have the power to press the reset button to change how our life should be. As the horizon stretches before us, we have the chance to make a difference, to make a mark that would serve our subsequent generations. Let us try not electing those who can only dance and sing in the campaign trail, but have no idea at all to solve our country's humongous problems. Let's try not voting into office people who are so corrupt to be able to buy our votes out of the millions and billions that they stole from us after we elected them 3 or 6 years ago. For a change, let us try to be more discerning and choose who we truly believe can best serve our people's interests. If we think we're wasting our votes on someone who we perceive might not win, but who we believe in our heart of hearts can best serve our country, and therefore for our own comfort, we decide to vote with the bandwagon, then we are really wasting our votes. I could not think of a better way to end my message this evening than leaving you with a simple quote from American cultural anthropologist Margaret Mead. She said, and I quote, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens, I will add, like the FEF, can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has." Thank you for listening. Mabuhay po ang FEF at mabuhay tayong lahat.